Welcome everyone to Young Researchers Colloquium. Our speaker today is Jacopo Schino, who is still affiliated with IMPAN. Jacopo has recently defended his PhD dissertation and obtained a title of Doctor of Philosophy. Congratulations to him. Jacopo will tell us about a simple approach to entire normalized solutions to an elliptic Schrödinger equation. Please, the floor is yours.
Okay, great. So thanks, Jacek, for the introduction. It's nice for me to be on the other side of the stage in some sense. After 5 semesters being a co-organizer, now I am back to giving talks as just a pure speaker. And I'm also happy I can give this goodbye talk before leaving IMPAN, which will happen soon. Thanks again to the organizers for accepting my proposal. Let me start saying that this is a rather long title, but the first aim for me is to explain all the concepts that you might not be familiar with in the title. So, what is the Schrödinger equation? What is in particular the elliptic Schrödinger equation? What does entire solution mean? What does normalized solution mean? So let's get started. Let me introduce the problem. So, the equation we study is this number one, where n, which is the space dimension, is, for the sake of simplicity, at least 2. P is any number between 2 and this threshold exponent, any number but this very one. We will see in the talk itself why we need to exclude this number. And this symbol here, this capital delta, is called the Laplace operator, and it's simply the sum of all the second order derivatives made along the same direction. So we don't have mixed derivatives here. And what we study equation number one paired with the L2 constraint number 2. So rho here is any given positive number. So rho is given. And we'll look for a solution U that's also simultaneously 1 and 2. While lambda here, which is also in the equation, is in general a real number and is part of the unknown. So we do not know lambda a priori. And at this point, I can already explain something. So first of all, we see that the whole equation lives in Rn, and this is the meaning of entire, because it's set in the entire Euclidean space. Now, as you can guess, this is the Schrödinger equation, in particular, the elliptic Schrödinger equation. And now, by elliptic, for simplicity, let's say that I simply mean that this equation has no time dependence. So you can think of the variable in Rn as the space variable, but there is no time variable. So this problem is time independent. Let's say that you can take this as the definition of elliptic problem. And what else? So what about normalized? Well, let's go to the second line. It's written here. And if we find a function u that solves both 1 and 2 for some value of lambda, well, we call this solution a normalized solution. And the reason is exactly that the norm, in this case, the L2 norm, is given a priori. And now, you might argue that if lambda is part of the unknown, then in fact, the solution is not just u, but the couple lambda u. For sure, you'd be right. But for the sake of simplicity, I would say that u is the solution to the equation, even though the unknowns are 2, lambda and u. So this should make some definitions and observations slightly easier. So now a couple of words about why we study such problems. And now we do look at the problem that depends on time.
At this point, am I right to think that this constraint second yes. is not really a problem, because if you find a solution to one, you can always rescale u so that two is satisfied?
Yeah, so okay, with this particular right hand side, you can.
Yes.
You can if p is different from this exponent. Because if p is exactly this exponent, then the scaling doesn't work. But yes, you can think of this problem as with lambda fixed, for instance, equal to one. For simplicity, it works with every positive lambda. So for simplicity, we can take lambda equal to one. Then you find you easily find a solution to this equation. And then you can scale u from outside and inside. I mean that instead of u of x, you can consider alpha times u of beta times x. And for, let's say, suitable values of alpha and beta, you can have a solution now to this equation with this particular constraint, and lambda will appear from this alpha and beta.
Okay, but it is not that trivial, this rescaling. Well, as you describe it.
So, Jacek?
Yes, can you hear me?
Okay, yes, now I can. I think that there was a problem with the connection or something.
Okay, so it was at your site, yes? Or at my, doesn't really matter.
I don't know.
Yeah, I guess it was at Jacopo's problem because I got, it broke down for me too.
Okay, well, but now again, you can see my screen and you can hear me, yes?
Yes.
Okay, so I was saying that, yes, by a scaling argument, you can solve this problem and then scale the, so for fixed lambda, and then scale the solution in order to have u with this constraint. But if you have a right-hand side that is not homogeneous, you can forget about this strategy because it doesn't work. So only if you have a power type function can you do this thing, otherwise no. In fact, the approach I will present today they are presented in this simple case, but they can of course be adapted to more general linearities, provided of course one has reasonable assumptions. And by the way, so it's good that you interrupted, because I forgot to say that for me it's perfectly fine that you interrupt anybody from the audience interrupts me and asks for a question instead of waiting till the end. Okay, so if you have no other questions for the moment, I can go on. I was saying, yes, a couple of words about why we study such problems. And in order to understand this, we have a look at the time dependent, the evolution equation. So this one is the classical Schrödinger equation, a simplified model. And you can see that the L2 space, L2 norm of the solution is conserved in time. It doesn't depend on t. And this is one possible reason to study normalized solutions. Another reason this is true. Then also, how do we get equation number one? Well, we start again from the time-dependent equation. And we make these ansatz. So we assume that phi of xt depends explicitly on time in this way. So these are called standing waves, sometimes stationary waves. So if we make these ansatz, then from the first equation of this system, we get equation number one. And the second equation of the system is why we study normalized solutions together with possible other reasons. For instance, the fact that the Schrödinger equation has many physical applications, also something in probability. And in all these fields, this quantity here has a precise meaning, which is another reason why we want to prescribe the L2 norm a priori. And so far, I have explained everything in that you might not know in the title, except for solutions. Well, because what is a solution to this equation? And you might think, okay, well, it's well, so we have two derivatives, so it's a C2 function such that this identity is satisfied everywhere on Rn. This is true in the end, but not something we'll see today, because today we're also going to see a new notion of solution. But in order to have this new notion of solution, we need to learn some preliminaries. So first of all, the space, function space where we look for such solutions. This space is called H1 and consists of all the functions in L2 such that each of their derivatives is again L2. And now you might be generally concerned from the fact that I'm taking derivatives of a function that is merely L2 summable, right? So what is the derivative of U in this case? Well, the derivative of U is defined, let's say, by duality. So if I manage to find a function that, well, thinking about the future, I now call du in dxj, such that this identity holds for every test function. So when a function has compact support and is infinity, I call it test function. So if I find such a function, du in dxj, such that this holds for all the test functions, then I say that this function here is the so-called weak derivative of u in xj. And the point is that it for this identity to hold, it is enough that du in dj, as well as u itself, are in L2. So we don't need any strong, yes? We don't need the classical definition of derivatives, but of course, if u is of class C1, then this function is just the classical derivative of u along xj. Okay, so this is our space. So the one here is because we take the first order derivatives. And one can prove that this embedding holds. So if q is any number between these two values, of course, if n equals 2, we have to exclude infinity, then h1 is embedded into lq. So this means that I can control the norm of lq from above with the norm of h1. Now, I still haven't said what the norm of h1 is, but as you can guess, this is something involving the l2 norm of u and the l2 norm of all the derivatives. And now we're ready to give the definition of solution in this case. So we consider now another function in H1, V, and we multiply the equation number one by V. We integrate, then we use the integration by part formula so that we can move one derivative from U to V in this term. And eventually what we get is this identity. If we start from the equation number one, from the formulation, the classical formulation one. And of course, all of these three guys are well defined because the derivatives of u and v are in L2. So this product is in L1. For the same reason, this product it is in L1 because u and v are in L2. And since u is in LQ and p is also strictly between these two numbers, then also this integral makes sense. This integrand function is still in L1. And now, if we succeed in finding a U in H1 such that this identity three is satisfied for every function v in H1, well, then we call u a weak solution to the equation number one. And now, from this moment on, when we talk of solutions to this problem, we will always mean solutions in this weak sense. Okay, so now how do we look for solutions? We look for critical points of some function. So let's see what do we mean by functionals or critical points of them. So, functional, of course, we know what it means. So we take, for the moment, an abstract functional defined on H1. We take two functions in u and v, and we want to define this guy, I prime of u evaluated at v. And exactly like in calculus, calculus one, calculus two, this is defined as the limit as t tends to zero of this incremental ratio. Like in calculus two, when we deal with function defined on Rn. And well, so this is the definition for every v. So now we have that I prime of u is a linear and continuous functional defined on H1. Well, now I'm cheating a little bit because by definition, this is I prime of u is always linear. In general, it need not be continuous, but let's say that we will only see continuous functionals. So, okay, we are in a situation that I prime of u for a fixed u is a continuous and a linear functional in H1. So it belongs to the dual space, and I will indicate the dual space with this prime here. Now, we have a map from H1 to H1 prime, the dual, and this map is I prime. Now, if I prime is of class, if this map is continuous, with the topology of H1 and the topology of H1 prime, then we say that I is of class C1. So nothing different from when we are in the finite dimensional case with function defined on Rn. Okay, now if we have a functional of class C1, we can introduce the concept of critical points. So like in calculus one, for instance, a critical point is an element of H1 such that I prime of u is zero, except now I prime of u is not a number, it's not a vector in Rn, but is itself a mapping. So saying that I prime of u is equal to zero, this means that as a mapping, this map is identically equal to zero. So apply that v is zero for every v from H1. And now we know what it means to be a critical point of a functional, but for the other slides, we need to understand what does it mean to be a critical point of a functional restricted to some set. And the first example is very easy. So if I have a functional that is of an H1 and an open subset of H1, and also a point from this open subset A, then saying that U is a critical point of I restricted to A is the very same thing as saying that U is a critical point of the unrestricted functional, because you are in an open subset and you can make derivatives along all the direction, basically. Once more, like in calculus two. But now we look at something a little bit more involved. So we need a second kind of sets. Let's say that the prototype is this Q. So Q is like simply the pre-image of zero via this function G. And on G, we have three assumptions, basically. So first of all, we want this set to be non-empty. Otherwise, there's not much to say. So we require that there are zeros of G. Then we need G to be another function of class C1 on H1. And finally, we need that whenever we take U from, not from the whole H1, but only from this set Q, then G prime of U is not identically zero. So we can always find a point in H1 B such that G prime of U at this B is non-zero. Okay, so this is the meaning of G prime of U not identically equal to zero. Okay, so now we wonder, what does it mean that U is a critical point of I restricted to Q? Well, from if you ever had like differential geometry courses, but also something simpler like a course about surfaces, you know that this means that I prime of u evaluated at v still is zero, but this time for every v from the tangent space, so tangent space at u to q, not for every v from each one, only from this tangent space. The point is that this piece of information is not so easy to use in some applied concrete sense. So let's have a look again at this line. This line says what? That I prime of u is orthogonal to this subspace. And but since now we take the definition of q, the set q, the orthogonal complement of a tangent space of this kind is a one-dimensional subspace of H1, and it is generated by exactly G prime of u. So this is why it is important to have G prime of u not identically zero. And therefore, if I prime of u belongs to the orthogonal complement of this space, and this orthogonal complement is one-dimensional spanned from G prime of u, this means that I prime of u is proportional to G prime of u via some scalar lambda. And in this case, lambda takes the name of Lagrange multiplier. And well, now we know what it means to be a critical point of a functional restricted to this kind of set. We can say more, and we need to say more, in fact, at least for the final part of the talk, because let's think of examples of critical points, even in one dimension, okay, with function defined on the real line. So the first example we have of critical points are minimizers and maximizers. Okay, let's focus on minimizers for the moment. We not minimize as a critical point, but in this case, can we say something about lambda if we know something more about u? And the answer, of course, is yes. Otherwise, I would not have asked the question. So if we know that not only is u a critical point of I restricted to q, but we also know two more things. That u is also a minimizer, and it is a minimizer not only of I restricted to q, but to this larger set. So instead of taking g of v equal to zero, we take g of v less than or equal to zero. So u is a minimizer of I to restricted to this larger set. Well, in this case, we can also say that lambda is non-negative. Now, this is not something I'm going to prove, because this would take some time, but so take it as an act of faith that this is true. And this is something we're going to use, except we with a slightly different notation. So we will basically put this term onto the left-hand side, change lambda to minus lambda. So we will use the result in this way. I prime of u plus lambda g prime of u equals zero, and lambda now is non-negative. We just need, you know, to change lambda with minus lambda. And this is more coherent. Oh, yes, there's a question.
Sorry, I'm just saying that it seems
Yes, but it makes sense. I thought it was a question from the audience. Anyway, so I used this notation because this is more coherent with the differential equation we're studying, with the lambda on the left-hand side. Okay, now, fortunately, the very basic preliminaries are done. We can enter the problem more entirely. If I can click, okay. Yeah, so far we have seen an abstract functional and abstract set Q. Now, the concrete functional is this one I call J, and this is closely related to our problem. Okay, so this is the definition of J, and just to be clear, when I say that, when I'm mentioned the modulus of the gradient of u, this is what the modulus is. At least the modulus squared is just the sum of the square of all the derivatives of u. And S, which plays the role of the abstract set Q, is the sphere in H2, but sphere taken with the L2 norm, with radius rho and centered at zero, of course. And applying what we've seen so far with some explicit computation, which I'm going to skip, we have that some u in S is a critical point of J restricted to S, if and only if J prime of u evaluated at V is zero for every V from this tangent space. So a critical point of this is a normalized solution to the problem 1, 2. Well, of course it is normalized because remember, 1 is the differential equation, 2 is the L2 constraint. And again, so lambda in the equation appears as a Lagrange multiplier, as we've seen in the previous slide. Okay, so normally when you deal with normalized problems, this is what you do. You just have this set S and then you work with J restricted to S. But the novelty of this approach that I would like to present is to work with a different set, still related with S, but a bit different. In order to do this, I need to recall these compact embeddings. So first of all, notations. When I say H1 rad, this means the subset of H1 consisting in radial function. A radial function is something that, okay, normally you would have U of X. A radial function is something like U of the modulus of X. So a function that only depends on the modulus of X instead of the whole X. Well, if you restrict yourself to this subspace, then you have compact, not just continuous, but compact embeddings, almost in the same integral as before. This time you have to exclude both endpoints. And just to be clear, by compact embedding, I mean that if you have a weakly convergent sequence in H1, then this sequence converges strongly in LQ. I will assume that you know what it means to be weakly convergent, but if you don't know, just tell me and we'll explain. This will be not the first time that I find somebody, you know, in the audience who doesn't know weak convergence. But so the problem is exactly that you need to exclude this endpoint, 2. 2, unfortunately, is exactly the exponent which is involved with the definition of S. So if we have now a sequence in S, we say that we can say that we can prove that this sequence is weakly convergent to some U, even if we work with radial functions, we don't know if the norm of U, the L2 norm of U is still rho, like it was for UN. So we don't know if this weakly midpoint still is in S, or if you prefer, S is not a weakly closed set. For this reason, instead of working with S, we work with D. D, instead of being the ball of radius rho, sorry, instead of being the sphere of radius rho, is the ball, or if you prefer, the disk. Still in H1, still taken with the L2 norm with radius rho. And clearly G is a weakly closed set because you know that even if the norm of U is strictly less than the limit of the norm of the UN, then since we are taking this inequality in the definition of D, the weakly limit point still belongs to U. Even if we don't work with radial functions, still the weak limit is in D. And this is an advantage because, well, knowing that the weak limit point is still in the set where we work, give us more information that we can use to finally solve the problem. And that's it. So now
I have a question.
It's time to go to the proof a bit more with in details.
Sorry, Jacopo. So,
yes?
Could you go back to the previous slide? I have a question. Is it that obvious that critical points of J are solutions to one? It is something I should be able to see immediately, or does it require some calculations?
Well, you just need to compute J prime of U times V, applied at V, remembering that, well, in this case, you will be in a situation like this, because it's not just, because you can only take V from this set. Well, then I don't think it's something difficult to see, but, well, you know, in order to check this, you just need to make some computations.
Okay.
So
that's
for me to see.
I was just wondering if I should be able to see it immediately.
No, but well, the point is that you can see that you have, so this is the definition of J. So now, so you have something quadratic here. If you go back to equation one, here you have something linear. Then here you have something to power, let's say p minus one, but in the definition of j, you have something to power p. So when you take the derivative, ideally what happens is that you the power decreases by one. And the lambda term, of course, comes from this side, from this thing. So even in this case, you have u squared, but in the equation, you have lambda times u. So instead of quadratic piece, you have a linear piece. And that's at least heuristically, this should more or less convince you that the critical points of J restricted to S are solutions to one and two. Well, to one, but they are critical, they satisfy two is obvious because they belong to S.
Okay, thank you.
So if you don't have further questions, I can go on.
Yes.
And now it's time to consider two cases separately. So first we will consider the so-called L2 critical case, sometimes called mass critical case. Well, in this talk, since there is no risk of misunderstanding, I think I will just call it the subcritical case, which as a definition for the moment, let's take this, that P is between two and this first number. You remember that P had to be different from this number. So first, let's see what happens when P is less than this number. And the main theorem is this. We find a radial normalized solution to 1, 2, normalized is in brackets because, well, this is just the definition of U belonging to S or U satisfying 2. We have that the Lagrange multiplier is strictly positive, and the energy level, that this is because J is sometimes called the energy functional, because in many applications it represents the energy level of our solution is negative. So this is the main theorem we want to prove. And you can see that it can be proved via a small number of lemmas. But before that,